Blackstone presents The Orphanage, a novel by Serhiy Zhadan, translated by Riley Costigan Humes and Isaac Stackhouse Wheeler. This book is read by Matthew Lloyd Davies.
Go pick him up!
Pasha's dad yells.
He's her son. She ought to pick him up.
Pasha retorts.
He's your nephew!
The old-timer reminds him.
So what?
And he's my grandson.
And the television is on the whole time. He never turns the television off, even at night. It's like their very own eternal flame, burning to commemorate the dead rather than entertain the living. The old-timer watches the weather report like he's expecting they'll mention him by name. After it ends, he just sits there, like he can't believe what he's heard. Pasha doesn't really watch TV, especially this past year. The news has been just plain scary. Pasha sits in his room on a couch by his desk, surrounded by textbooks, until he can't stand it anymore. Then he jerks to his feet, goes outside. Springs protrude from the couch like twigs from a Boy Scouts campfire. The furniture in the house is old, yet full of life. It'll probably outlive its owners. Pasha's sister suggested they at least get some new chairs, but he simply brushed her off. What's the point of hauling stuff around? That's like doing pull-ups when you're 70. Yeah, sure, go right ahead. Just make sure you take some ibuprofen first. His sister hardly comes by anymore. So nobody's talking about hauling furniture around anymore either. Pasha liked their house. He'd lived here his whole life and planned to keep on living here. It was built by German POWs shortly after the war, a rather spacious duplex on the second street back from the train station. Their densely populated settlement, which was mostly home to railroad workers, was built around that station. So they'd often refer to their whole town as the station. It gave them work. It gave them hope. Like a heart blackened by locomotive smoke, pumping the blood of the local gullies and windbreaks. Life still revolved around the station even now, with the depot as empty as a drained swimming pool and the repair shops unused, if you didn't count the bums and swallows that slept there. There just weren't any jobs now. Sure, maybe they lived in a so-called workers' settlement, but they were the first to find themselves out of work. The shops were shut down, and the people scurried off in all directions, hiding in crowded apartment blocks with wells dried up by the scorching summer and cellars where the supplies had already run out by Christmas. Pasha didn't have anything to complain about, though. He was on the government payroll.
Yep. Yep,
Pasha thought as he shut the front door, insulated with hospital blankets, behind him.
I'm on the government payroll, even if I'm not actually getting paid all that much.
The snow, blue-pink, with deep, dark pores, reflects the evening sky and the approaching sunset. Sharp to the touch, smells of March water, conceals black, viscous earth, renders weather reports unnecessary. The winter will last long enough for everyone to get accustomed to it. Suck it up and learn to cope. And then something else will begin. For the time being, the world feels like a lump of snow in someone's warm hands. It melts, releases its water, but the longer that goes on, the colder their hands get, the less warm motion they retain, the more icy stillness seeps into them. The water remains lethal, even as it melts. The sun drowns in an intricate system of watery mirrors and reflections. Nobody can really get warm. Right after lunch, once the wet blaring of horns announcing shift changes at the station subsides, twilight sets in, and that illusory sensation of warmth, of a thaw, disappears again. Pasha skirts the building and takes the soggy path through the trees. They had always shared the duplex with a railroad worker. Half the building belonged to him, half to Pasha's tight-knit family. Mum, Dad, Pasha, and his older sister.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.